Captain Doom.
If tomorrow all the things were gone, I'd work for all my life, and I had to start again with just my children and my wife.
I thank my lucky stars to be living here today, where the flag still stands for freedom, and they can't take that away.
From the lakes of Minnesota
to the hills of Tennessee,
across the plains of Texas, oh, from sea to shining sea,
from Detroit down to Houston,
New York to LA,
where there's pride in every American heart,
and it's time we stand and say.
Again, I want to welcome you. You'll find in the pew rack in front of you a sheet of paper here. It's got just a couple things on one side of some announcements. Of course, we haven't been making bulletins and passing those out. So we've got announcements on one side, and on the other side is the message outline for today if you want to take notes. So on this weekend, when we're celebrating the birth and the independence of our great country, we come to Acts chapter 12 in this journey we have been on through this amazing account of an extraordinary God working through ordinary people to accomplish an extraordinary mission with God-sized results. The church, as you know, started in Acts chapter 1 with just 120 people. Quickly, though, they grew to 3,000 and then 5,000 and then past 10,000. But from early on in this study, we have seen that as the church in Jerusalem grows rapidly and grows large, opposition equally escalates in an increasing measure. And so on this weekend, when we celebrate the birth and independence of our country, we recognize also there is much unrest in our country. We're aware of the social and the political, the civil and the religious unrest. And as Christians, we're also troubled by the escalating animosity and harassment and hostility toward God and the Christian faith and the church. It's driven by the public education system, by colleges and universities, by the cancel culture and political correctness zealots, by the Hollywood elite, by the predominantly left-leaning media. And we see our rights as Christians being challenged as never before in our nation's history. And this opposition is moving full steam ahead here in the third decade of this 21st century. I want to read something to you that John MacArthur, many of you know who John MacArthur is. He's a pastor out in California, and he wrote these words, which will be on the screen. The hostility of our own nation toward Christianity is just now beginning to escalate. And as the wicked and perverse people of our culture find there are no cultural restraints, no Christian influences in the culture itself, they will continue to become aggressive in their evil. And they will, in being aggressive, want to trample anybody who stands in the way or questions the right or the wrong of what they do. And consequently, there will be an escalating hostility against Christians who take a strong stand. This seems to be moving and escalating all over the world and may well be but a harbinger of what is to come in worldwide hostility toward God and His church. And I think his words are so absolutely true and an accurate description of what is taking place right now. But John MacArthur penned these words in 1993, 27 years ago. And the very things that he predicted then are the very things we're experiencing today. Now, this war against God, it has been going on ever since Satan decided that he wanted to be like the Most High. God subsequently banished him from heaven. And he took a third of the angels with him. And they have orchestrated this long war against God ever since. And they employ all the human beings they can to engage in this war, to destroy God, his purposes, his kingdom, and even the reign and rule of his church. And we see that clearly in the book of Acts. Satan is active throughout the pages of Acts as he's attempting to destroy this young church and the first generation of believers in Jesus. And he uses a varied arsenal of weapons in his effort to stop the spread of Christianity. We've seen opposition, haven't we, coming from the Jewish religious leaders. We've seen that multiple times. But that only resulted in the further spread of Christianity. Satan then tries to destroy the church from the inside by filling the heart of a husband and wife who were leaders in the early church, Ananias and Sapphira, yet the church continued to grow rapidly. And then next, Satan tried to create racial and ethnic division among the believers. But the apostles moved quickly to quell that attempt, and the church continued to grow. Here in Acts chapter 12, we see more opposition against the young church coming through King Herod Agrippa. But it doesn't stop the church. In 2 weeks, we're going to be at Acts 15, and we're going to see how Satan tries a different approach. He creates a doctrinal and theological debate within and among the church leadership that threatens to split the church in two. But once again, he fails. The church continues to grow exponentially. Let's pick up the story today in Acts chapter 12. I'll begin with the first four verses. About that time, King Herod Agrippa began to persecute some believers in the church. He had the apostle James, John's brother, killed with a sword. When Herod saw how much this pleased the Jewish people, he also arrested Peter. This took place during the Passover celebration. Then he imprisoned him, placing him under the guard of four squads of four soldiers each. Herod intended to bring Peter out for public trial after the Passover. Now, though he was born and educated in Rome, this Herod Agrippa, he believes in the God of the Israelites, the one God. And he strove, even though he's Roman, he strove to be viewed favorably by the Jewish leadership. And he understood the threat to the Jews that they perceived from this rapidly growing sect of believers in Jesus. And so Herod is seeking their favor. And he concludes that one way he could endear himself to the Jewish leaders would be to go directly after the leadership of the church, which is really a common strategy of Satan in his war against God. Because when a leader is brought down, especially if it's a moral failure of some sort, when a leader is brought down, the church often suffers for it. Satan knows this, and so he through Herod, goes after the leadership of the church. And James is the first of the apostles to be put to death. Except for the apostle John, all 12 of the apostles will eventually be put to death for their faith. James is beheaded, and Herod sees how much this pleased the Jewish leaders, so he next goes after Peter. Herod has Peter arrested and imprisoned. And out of abundance of caution, he is guarded by 16 soldiers. Now, 16 verse 1, that's not really a fair fight. And if those odds aren't strong enough, he also orders that Peter is chained at the wrists to two of the soldiers. While this is going on, Luke tells us in verse 5 that while Peter was in prison, the church prayed earnestly for him. You could jump down to verse 12 where we see that the many of the believers were what? They were gathered for prayer. Now keep in mind, it is nighttime when all of this is happening. And so the early church is basically having an all-night, overnight prayer meeting. So let's recap what's going on. James is beheaded, likely following some sham trial that Peter is about to put through. Peter is in prison, no doubt aware of what happened to James, that he was put through the sham trial and then beheaded. Peter's got to figure, this is what's going to happen to me. God's people are together praying earnestly while all of this is going on. Let's see what happens in verse 6. And so the night before Peter was to be placed on trial, he was asleep, fastened with two chains between two soldiers, while others stood at guard at the prison gate. And I love the fact that Luke here, the author of the book of Acts, tells us that Peter was asleep the night before his trial was to begin. I mean, Peter wasn't worried. He wasn't losing any sleep over his circumstances. His trust and his confidence in God were so high that he was able to sleep. And as we'll see a little bit later, he was able to sleep deeply. You know it, right? Worry often manifests itself in the ability to fall asleep. Not so with Peter, though. It was the same kind of sleep that Jesus experienced when there was a storm on the water as he and the disciples were in a boat. The disciples were afraid they were going to drown, and they literally had to wake Jesus up, pushing him, wake up, Jesus, wake up, because the storm didn't wake him up. He just slept right through it. So what gives Peter such confidence and peace that the night before he's expected to have a sham trial and likely be beheaded as happened to James? What gives him such confidence and peace? Well, many believers were praying for him. And they kept it up day and night for a week. This was the source of Peter's strength and his peace and his calmness. You know, we've all experienced that strength and that calm that comes to us when we know others are praying for us. We're going through a situation. It could be medical, financial, or relational, or whatever it is, and we're feeling the pressure. And we do the right thing. We turn to our Christian friends. We turn to our Connect group. We turn to our Sunday school class. We turn to people in our church, and we say, listen, I need you to pray for me. I need you to pray for me. And they do, and they're praying for you, and you could begin to feel the change, right? You begin to sense, man, these people are praying for me. I'm stronger than I thought I was. I'm feeling more at peace than I figured I would. I have more courage than I thought possible because people are praying for me. So that's what's going on. Peter is in kind of a tough situation, but the church is praying for him. Well, let's continue at verses 7 through 11. Suddenly, there was a bright light in the cell, and an angel of the Lord stood before Peter. The angel struck him on the side to awaken him and said, quick, get up. The chains fell off his wrists. Then the angel told him, get dressed and put on your sandals, and he did. Now, put on your coat and follow me, the angel ordered. So Peter left the cell, following the angel. But all the time, he thought it was a vision. He didn't realize it was actually happening. And so they passed the first and second guard post and came to the iron gate leading to the city, and this opened for them all by itself. So they passed through and started walking down the street. The angel suddenly left him. Peter finally came to his senses. It's really true, he said. The Lord has sent his angel and saved me from Herod and from what the Jewish leaders plan to do to me. Now, of course, this isn't the first time Peter escapes from prison. He's done this at least once before in Acts chapter 5, and Herod must have known this. So I think that's why Herod puts these 16 soldiers guarding Peter this time, figuring, listen, the guy is an escape risk. He's done it once already. And then interestingly, this bright light appears in the cell, but it doesn't wake Peter up. That doesn't even seem to wake up the two guards that he's chained to, or maybe even the other 14 guards. But Peter himself was in such a deep sleep that the angel had to go and poke him on the side and say, Peter, wake up, wake up, wake up. Now, I don't know what you're like when you are woken suddenly. I can tell you, I'm not too coherent when I'm suddenly woken. Real early in Susie and I's marriage, my very first ministry was in a rural community, Morristown, Ohio. It was in Highland County, southern rural Ohio. It was a farming community, man. You talk about a New York guy being a fish out of water. I was a fish out of water in this community. But one night, it was a Sunday night. We had gone to bed. We were sound asleep. All of a sudden, we hear the doorbell ringing and somebody knocking on the door. So I jump out of bed and I put my glasses on and I start going toward the door. You know, this was the day when somebody knocked on your door and you weren't afraid to open it, right? And so this guy's knocking and the bell ringing and I'm going, and just about I'm ready to grab the door and fling it wide open. Susie says, Michael, stop. And I stop. She says, you're in your underwear. Go put some clothes on. I said, oh yeah. And so I scurried and put some clothes on and I opened up the door, and turned out it was a deputy sheriff. A couple of doors had been left open in the church building, and he wanted to, I don't know why he didn't just go in there and shut the doors and not waking me up in the middle of the night, but that's what he chose to do. So I'm not very coherent when I wake up, and apparently Peter wasn't either, because he's not sure what's going on. Well, after the chains fell off his wrists, Peter still has to get dressed. And so he gets his shoes on, he gets dressed, he puts his coat on, and then he has to follow the angel past the other 14 Roman soldiers right out of the prison as the locked gates opened on their own. I mean, this was so miraculous that even Peter himself didn't believe at first that it was happening. He concluded that he was having this crazy dream that felt real. You ever have them dreams? You just feel like they're real, but you know they're a dream and you're not sure what's going on. But finally, outside of the prison, Peter's kind of like touching himself and he's looking around and he doesn't have chains. He's like, whoa, this isn't a dream. This has really happened. So wasn't Peter, the preacher, turned prisoner, turned escapee, turned fugitive? What does he do now? Well, he heads where he knew his closest Christian friends would be. And gee, there's a whole sermon just in that. And so he arrives at the house where these people are, and they're having this prayer meeting, and he knocks on the door, and apparently he's trying to yell to get their attention. Somebody in there, let me in, let me in, let me in. The people were gathered and they were praying, and I'm guessing that Peter could hear them praying at the door into the house. It's sort of like when I go to India and we have prayer times. Now, here in America, it's very different than the way they pray in India. Here in America, I might say, well, Jack, would you lead us in a word of prayer? And we all would what? We would bow our heads and we would shut up. And Jack would pray and we'd listen to his prayer. Well, that's not the way it is in India. When you say, let us pray, they all start praying at one time. I mean, they're all just going at one time. Everybody's praying, and they pray real excitedly, and they pray real earnestly and real fervently. And so you get all these people, and they're all praying at the same time. And we're not accustomed to it because we're used to, let us pray. But they don't pray like that. But it's interesting that, you know, God, he understands it all. He hears every one of those prayers as if it's the only one talking to him. I mean, think about it now. How many people are praying to God right at this moment? God doesn't have a problem deciphering what everybody's saying, talking all at once. You know, when I'm leading meeting and stuff, and I'm like, we all stop talking at once. I can't hear you. I don't know what you're saying. And God doesn't do that. So all these people, they're praying and they're praying excitedly. And Peter's out there banging on the door and he's trying to get their attention and yelling out to them. Well, finally, somebody hears the door knocking. Sounds like somebody out there yelling. And so they go approach the door and the person, she recognizes Peter's voice. She says, I know that voice. That's Peter out there. But instead of running and opening up the door, she does a 180 and runs back to tell everybody, hey, Peter is standing outside the door. Peter's thinking, well, you just let me in already. So she goes and pick it up at verse 15 here. She goes and tells everybody, well, listen, Peter's at the door. You're out of your mind, they said. When she insisted, they decided it must be his angel. And I love Luke. Meanwhile, Peter continued knocking. And when they finally opened the door and saw him, they were amazed. So we don't know how much time there was between when Peter first started knocking on the door and they finally opened up the door, but it was a length of time. I mean, Luke says, meanwhile, and finally, I mean, like, I tend to be really, really prompt on things, and somebody might not be as prompt as I, and I may be like, meanwhile. All right, you're finally ready? And so Luke is, I think he's emphasizing, like, these people are just, they're just dragging their feet here. They're not in any rush. Well, they finally unlock the door. And when they see it, it's indeed Peter. So now, once again, everybody starts talking at the same time. And likely they're just speaking words of praise to God in amazement. And they're all going at one time. And Peter's like, guys, quiet down. Quiet down. You're going to wake up the whole neighborhood. Remember, this is in the middle of the night. So Peter goes in the house and he quickly gives an account of this miraculous deliverance and he thanks them for their prayers. And then he instructs them to get the word of his release to James, who obviously was a different James than the James who was beheaded at the beginning of the chapter. And Luke then tells us that Peter went to another place. Now, where Peter went, nobody knows to this day. It was a well-kept secret. Well, as we wrap this up today, I want to make three observations from our text. Wouldn't be a Mike Cassara sermon without three observations. Once in a while, I'll go to four, but three observations. Number one, opposition to the gospel will only increase as we draw nearer to the return of Christ. Opposition, it's only going to increase as we draw nearer to the return of Christ. You can go way back into the history of the Old Testament, and you can see this long war against God. And it is often powerful people, influencers in the society, leaders in the political world, who become pawns of Satan as he fights against the God and God's purposes and God's glory. And he uses people to get his work done. They may not even be aware they're being used. They don't know they're being used. They don't realize they're a pawn in the hand of Satan. Whether you're in Egypt and it's Pharaoh, or you're in Moab and it's Balak, you're the king of Ai, or you're one of the five kings in Joshua 9. They all fought against God and his people and his purposes. And this continues right through the rest of the Old Testament and right into the New Testament. You see, Satan is always engaged in some manner fighting against God and God's people and God's purposes. So really, we shouldn't be surprised by what we are observing and experiencing today in regard to the opposition against the present-day church. Herod, in Acts 12, he is just another in a long line of powerful political leaders that Satan employs in his futile attempt to bring down the church. And certainly throughout the New Testament, we're reminded by Jesus and the authors of the New Testament that we will face persecution and suffering for our faith. God's people have always faced opposition and suffering. And the Bible tells us that the opposition and suffering is only going to escalate in the last days. Every action of God through his Holy Spirit-empowered people has an equal and opposite satanic reaction from those who are merely pawns on Satan's chessboard. Yeah, how many of you, when you first became a Christian, were told something like, listen, Jesus loves you and he has this wonderful plan for your life, that if you confess your sins to Jesus and you're baptized, he will forgive you, and when you die, he's going to take you to heaven and you're going to live with him forever. Would you like to become a Christian? I mean, that's the way most of us had it presented to us. And those of us who have presented it to other people, that's basically the way we present it to other people. But what we forget is to talk about the middle. The time between give your life to Jesus, confess your sins, and get baptized, and the time where you die and go to heaven and be with Jesus for eternity. We forget to talk about the middle, that part that we call life. And it is in that part, they forgot to tell us that, hey, people are going to hate you because of your stand for Jesus. People are going to say horrible things about you because of your stand for Jesus. If you're faithful and you're unashamed of the gospel, it might cost you your job. Your family and your friends may turn their back on you. It's going to be incredibly difficult. But do you want to become a Christian? See, we tend to leave that part out. But it's a very, very normal part of the follower of God's experience. And the Bible says it's only going to increase as we draw nearer to the return of Christ. That's why Paul told Timothy, listen, all who desire to live a godly life will be persecuted. Number two, the best response to opposition is faith-filled prayer and action. Faith-filled prayer and action. You know what's almost hilarious here in Acts chapter 12 is the reaction of the people who gathered together to pray earnestly for Peter. They've been praying for him for like a week now. And they couldn't believe that the person on the other side of the door could be Peter, even though Peter was who they had been praying for. I mean, I think the scene here is, it's almost a bit comical, isn't it? I mean, the answer to their prayers is standing on the other side of the door, but they don't have faith enough to open the door and let him in. And so poor Peter has to keep knocking and calling out while the believers in the prayer meeting are trying to decide, well, what do we do? What do? You answer it. I'm not answering it. No, you answer it. I'm not going near there. But it sounds like Peter. It can't be. You're crazy. Go answer it. I'm not answering it. And this just goes on. And, you know, Peter's wishing like he had a cell phone so he could text these people and say, it's me. Open the door already. Right? You know, James, not the James who's beheaded, but the James, Jesus's brother, he wrote this. The earnest prayer of a righteous person has great power and produces wonderful results. See, this name James pops up several times in Acts 12. So let me quickly explain to you who these two James are. James, who was beheaded in Acts 12, he's the brother of John. And he was one of the original followers and apostles of Jesus. We've known him way back since Matthew chapter 3 when James and John first met Jesus on the shore of Lake Galilee. Now, the James who Peter wanted to get a message to and who wrote the book of James, that's a different James. That James is Jesus' brother, and he was not an apostle. In fact, he didn't even believe that Jesus was the Messiah until after his brother Jesus died and rose again. That's when this James finally became a believer. And he grew quickly, and he became one of the leaders of the first church in Jerusalem. And it is this James who wrote the New Testament book of James and said, listen, the prayer of a righteous person is powerful. It's effective. And I'm sure when he penned these words about the power of prayer, he had no doubt was thinking about this event of Peter's miraculous escape from prison and how the church had been praying and praying for him earnestly for his release. James thinks back to that time and said, man, even if they don't know it, the power of fervent prayer is effective, even if the person praying it isn't even sure of it. You see, prayer is the key to God's power. And in this situation, the church was praying earnestly. And while they were praying, God in his marvelous power was moving in response to their earnest prayers. I mean, many years later, Peter wrote a letter. And he quotes Psalm 34, a verse he knew well and he knew was absolutely true. It says this, the eyes of the Lord watch over those who do right, whose ears are open to their prayers. And Peter's saying, I'm a living example of that. I know that to be true because I was in prison several times and people were praying for me and I got delivered right out of that prison. So let's think about it again. James is beheaded. Peter is arrested and he's sitting in a prison. And the church was praying very earnestly. They were gathered together to pray for Peter. And that verse that tells us that the church was praying, that really is the turning point in this whole story. And so please never underestimate the power of a praying church. The Puritan preacher Thomas Watson, he said this, and it's good. The angel fetched Peter out of the prison, but it was prayer that fetched the angel. Isn't that good? Listen again. The angel fetched Peter out of prison, but it was prayer that fetched the angel. See, when we pray earnestly for something, do we really believe that God's going to answer that prayer? I mean, we say we do. But if we're honest, we're not completely sure. And in today's text, the believers were reluctant to believe that God had indeed answered their prayer. What was their response when the young girl says, hey, it's Peter on the other side? They're like, are you crazy? There's no possible way it could be Peter. He's been imprisoned. He's got 16 guards watching him. He's chained to two of them. I mean, if they really believed God was going to answer their prayers, wouldn't they have immediately ran and opened up the door? Right? You know, my prayers, they can sound so full of faith when I pray them. But admittedly, my actions often tell otherwise. I can pray for something earnestly, but I won't always behave as if I believe God's going to actually answer that prayer. And I think that's why Luke emphasizes this when he writes, they finally opened the door. They prayed for Peter's release, but they delayed any action that would indicate they really believed God would answer their prayer. So here in Acts 12, we see faith-filled prayer, but the faith-filled action kind of lags a little behind. And just like the rest of God's word, the shortcomings and the weaknesses of God's people are not hidden away. They're out there on display for all of us to see. You know, if Acts was made up and not real history, as some people claim, Luke would have written that the believers immediately opened the door, absolutely confident and sure that God answered their prayers. But that's not what happened. And that's not what Luke tells us. He tells us they were reluctant to believe that God answered their prayer. And they were slow to move into action. And you know what? We can learn from them. Faith-filled prayer should be followed by faith-filled action. When you pray earnestly for something, act as if you are 100% sure God's going to answer that prayer. Now, he may not answer it the way you prayed it, and that is his sovereign right, but I think we should act like he is. Listen, the chapter here at chapter 12, it begins with James' beheading. Now, I'm certain that the church was praying for James as well and for his safety. Yet he gets beheaded and Peter gets released. How is that fair? Well, it doesn't have to be fair. God is right and just in all that he does. Sometimes he'll answer prayer as we pray it, other times he won't. But I think we always need to act and move forward in faith that he will answer our prayers. And if he doesn't, it just means he has something much better for us. You see, from our perspective, it's not fair that James gets beheaded and Peter gets released. But James gets to go right to heaven. Peter's got to go back out into a cruel world that opposes in every way possible the message he is preaching. Spends another 20 to 30 years preaching and facing harsh opposition, only to die when he was crucified upside down. That would be a horrible experience. But at least when you're beheaded, it's quick and relatively painless. I've heard, I've never experienced that myself, but I've heard. You know, God may not have answered the prayer for James's release as the people prayed, but he had something so much better in store for James. James was okay. Don't feel sorry for James. See, folks, we got to move forward believing that God's going to answer our prayers as we pray them. And we got to trust that if he doesn't, he has something so much better in store for us. Finally, number three, it is ultimately foolish to fight against God. In spite of the long history of societies and rulers and influencers and powerful people opposing the gospel and the principles of the Christian message, it is ultimately foolish to fight against God because God cannot be contested. Jesus said the gates of hell cannot prevail against the church. And so throughout the Bible, every ruler, every king, every powerful person lost in their fight against God. And that is true here in Acts chapter 12. Following Peter's escape from prison and his subsequent disappearance, Luke tells us next about King Herod and how he is being hailed as a god by a delegation of people who are attempting to make peace with him. Look at verse 22 and verse 23. The people gave him a great ovation, shouting, "It is the voice of the god, not of a man." Well, instantly, an angel of the Lord struck Herod with a sickness because he accepted the people's worship instead of giving the glory to God. So he was consumed with worms and he died.
Well, what about the Church of Jesus Christ, whom he was persecuting? Verse 24, meanwhile, the word of God continued to spread, and there were many new believers. Herod died, and the word of God continued to spread, and there were many new believers. Listen, persecution doesn't stop the work of God. Internal issues don't stop the work of God. Cultural division and distinctives don't stop it. And we'll see in 2 weeks that even a heated doctrinal and theological dispute among the leaders of the church couldn't stop the work of God from moving forward. And I honestly believe that what's happening in America today regarding Christianity can be a spark that ignites another great revival in our land. You know, there's a thing that happens in sports teams. In sports, when a team starts winning, they get a lot of new fans, right? Everybody jumps on the proverbial bandwagon. Well, right now, anti-Christian sentiment and anti-Christian sexuality and anti-Christian morality, it all feels like it's winning right now. And it seems like everybody's just jumping on this anti-God, anti-Christian bandwagon. And times like this sometimes cause people to question whether or not there really is a God, or if there is a God, does he care or is he even able to help us? You see, when we're suffering, it feels like the circumstances are sovereign, not God. And so you get anxious and you get stressed and you get worried and you cry out, God, what's the plan here? I don't know what the plan is. What's the plan? And you know what God says? He says, the plan is trust me. That's it. That's the plan. Trust me. And that's exactly what Peter did each time he was arrested for preaching the gospel. And he was chained to 2 Roman soldiers with 14 other guards guarding him. He went to sleep, and he slept so well that the angel had to poke him, fight him, to get him wake up. So the Bible says, now we see in part, but then we shall see in full. And we will know as we are fully known. Right now, I don't know what the plan is. I only see in part. But the day's going to come when I'll see it in full. But for now, I may not know what the plan is, but I know the one who created the plan. I know the one who is sovereign over the plan. I know the one who holds the plan in the palm of his hand. And so that's enough. I don't need to trust the plan. I just need to trust the God who holds the plan in his hand. And in his grace, he allows us to look back on our life and say, you know what? The God who was faithful yesterday will be faithful tomorrow. And the part of God's plan that I'm looking at right now, it's not the plan I thought God would have for me, and it's not the plan I would have chosen for me. But by God's grace, I'm going to trust him that it's a glorious plan. You see, God is sovereign, and he has a plan. And every single one of us are a part of his plan. God's going to do everything he promises to do, and he empowers you to do what he's asking you to do so that you're working in sync with God to accomplish his purposes through your life. God, who was faithful yesterday, will be faithful today and will be faithful tomorrow. I want you to just kind of close your eyes right now, bow your head. I want to just finish up by reading Revelation chapter 2, verses 10 and 11. I want you to just think about these words. Be faithful unto death, and I will give you the crown of life. For he who has an ear, let him hear what the Spirit says to the churches. He who overcomes will not be hurt by the second death. Father, we thank you that we have confidence in you, that God, even if we see in part, you have the full plan in your hand, and you've got it under control. So God, just help us to trust you as opposition to your word increases, God. Help us to just trust you, pray faithfully, act faithfully. And God, know that you've got this. You've got this, and we don't need to worry. We just need to trust. And we pray these things in the name of Jesus, our Lord and Savior. Amen. Amen.